To worship with the Shared Lutheran Ministry of Fayette County. Today is Sunday, October 3rd, 2021, and we are recording from the St. John's Lutheran Church in Warrenton. During this service, we will have communion, so be sure to locate your elements for the time of Holy Communion. This is the 19th Sunday after Pentecost. My name is Kristen Hullab, and I am one of the musicians for Shared Lutheran Ministry. And we would like to thank Pastor Tracy from the Synod office for providing the sermon and the communion portion of our worship today. Some announcements. Today we are having breakfast church in Ellinger and Rudersville, and at 3 o'clock p.m. Sunday school in Rudersville as well. Tuesday at 9:30 a.m. Rudersville Welka will have their business meeting, followed at 10:30 by the Welka Bible Study in Rudersville. Wednesday at 5:30 p.m., confirmation classes will meet in Rudersville. Saturday at 7:30 a.m., there is a breakfast Bible study at Riverside Cafe at 8 a.m. And next Sunday, there will be breakfast church at Warrenton and Fayetteville. At 11 a.m., St. John's Ellinger will have their roast beef and sausage dinner. Our opening hymn will be For the Beauty of the Earth.
Thank you.
Continue with the greeting. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Our opening litany is from Psalm 8. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
You whose glory is chanted above the heavens out of the mouths of infants and children. You have set up a fortress against your enemies to silence the foe and avenger.
When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you have set in their courses,
what are mere mortals that you should be mindful of them, human beings that you should care for them?
Yet you have made them a little less than divine. With glory and honor, you crowned them.
You have made them rule over the works of your hands. You have put all things under their feet.
All flocks and cattle, even the wild beasts of the field.
The birds of the air, the fish of the sea, and whatever passes along the path of the sea.
O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The prayer of the day. Let us pray. Sovereign God, you have created us to live in loving community with one another. Form us for life that is faithful and steadfast, and teach us to trust like little children, that we may reflect the image of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Genesis 2 stresses that people are not meant to live in isolation, but in relationship. Out of love for humanity, God creates them, male and female, to provide companionship for each other and to become with each other one flesh. The Hebrew words used here are ish, man, and ishosh, woman. Our scripture reading is taken from the second chapter of Genesis, verses 18 through 24. The Lord God said, "It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner." So out of the ground, the Lord God formed every animal of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all cattle, and to the birds of the air, and to every animal of the field. But for the man, there was not found a helper as his partner. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. Then he took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of man this one was taken. Therefore a man leaves his father and his mother and clings to his wife, and they become one flesh. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus announced and enacted in history the new reality of God's surprising activity. These two stories demonstrate his new reality. Women and children are accepted and valued, not dismissed as inferior to adult men. Today's gospel is taken from the 10th chapter of Mark, verses 2 through 16.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Some Pharisees came, and to test Jesus, they asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her." But Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. He said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
A reading from Hebrews, the first chapter. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways through the prophets. But in these last days, God has spoken to us by a Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being. And he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. Here's what stood out to me in today's reading from Hebrews. There is a repetition, and it's there purposefully. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets. And then later we hear, God has spoken to us by a Son. And then we are reminded that it is God's speech which created the world. It was in the beginning that God spoke everything into being. So I got to thinking, why this emphasis on God's speech? Again and again, our reading repeats it. The writer takes us back to the beginning, emphasizing that this word that is with us now has been with us all the way back to the beginning. We get glimpses, if we read through the book of Hebrews, as to why the author of Hebrews wanted to emphasize God's speaking. It's scattered throughout the book. In fact, this book is really more of a sermon than an epistle or a letter, which is what we sometimes call it. These words were written to the community that had started as a mission church, a mission site, if you will. And in their beginning, they had an incredible zeal for God's word. They started out sharing that word, witnessing with excitement and energy. In the second chapter of Hebrews, we can read about their worship life, which was vital and vibrant. And this enthusiastic group would go out from worship and share what Jesus was doing and saying among them. The problem was that as they began to witness and to speak God's message into the world, they butted up against a community that did not understand them. In fact, many were critical of this new community and their newfound love of Jesus. Their focus on the gospel was met not with excitement and energy, but instead with controversy. At first, those believers rallied, and they witnessed no matter what. But if you read through the book, by the time you get to chapter 10, you will see that these early followers wearied of the criticism. They spoke less of their faith and their church. And finally, the writer says, they had become apathetic, some neglecting to meet with the community at all. Because of the criticism they had experienced when they witnessed to God's word, their zeal and their proclamation was finally silenced. Some years ago, before I was a pastor, before I went to seminary, I taught 7th and 8th grade Spanish at a Christian junior high school. This was not an ELCA school, but a school affiliated with another denomination. While I was there, I answered a call to doing ministry in a new way. I had taken a number of my students on mission trips during the summers, and every time I got back from one of those trips, I would experience God nudging me to ordained ministry. But I would quickly squelch that, teach for another year, take youth on another mission trip, and then experience God's call again. Finally, I couldn't deny it anymore, and so I applied to seminary, and I was accepted. And the time came for me to tell the principal of my school that I would not be returning to teach the following year, because I was going to seminary to become a pastor. Now, this church school was affiliated with a tradition that did not ordain women. And I don't know what I expected my principal to say. Congratulations. I'm so proud of you. Something like good luck. Instead, my principal became very concerned about what she called messaging. We have to be careful, she said, about how we talk about this. give me some time to think about what we are going to say. I was rather naive about what she meant. But a few weeks later, I read in our school's newsletter, "Our beloved Spanish teacher will be leaving our school at the end of the year in order to pursue a graduate degree." Now, that was a message. It was not untrue, but it wasn't entirely true either. My students had all sorts of questions for me as the news traveled. Where was I going? Where was I going to live? What kind of school was it? What would I study? I became very good at restraint. Like the message my principal had shared, I said just enough, but not too much, worrying about offending the administration or the families who sent their students to our school. Like that community in the book of Hebrews, my zeal and enthusiasm had butted up against a community that did not understand me, and my proclamation was silenced. That is, until the last day of the school year. On that morning of my last day as a teacher, I started out by telling my first period class about my call to ministry. I said something like, "You've heard that I am going to grad school, and that's true. But the kind of school I'm going to is called the seminary, and it is a place where I will be trained to be a pastor." Now, a seventh grader in my homeroom class, whose name was Hope, she replied to me. She was the first to say anything in response to my proclamation. "Wait a minute," she said. "Does this mean you are going to be ordained?" I nodded my head. And she clasped her hands together and said something I will never forget. "Yay, you!" That started a chain reaction, and the rest of my class applauded, and a number of them got out of their seats to come and hug me. Throughout the day, my students affirmed my call to ministry. And because of them, and because of the gift of the Holy Spirit, I am speaking God's word to you today. In this highly charged, oftentimes deeply divided world in which we live and move and have our being, if you find yourself having to show restraint, if you've been holding in God's word because you are afraid about offending someone, if you are holding in a proclamation to the point of weariness, if your zeal about Jesus or your church have been silenced by powers that be encouraged by this lesson from Hebrews today. God's word still creates life. And God is still speaking today. God speaks through seventh graders, through prophets, and through proclaimers. Which is to say, God speaks through you. In these last days, God has spoken to us by a son. And that son is God's yay, you. In Jesus, God has the first and the last word. Amen. Thank you.
let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We have come to the offering time during our service. Shared Lutheran Ministry would like to thank you for your continued support of our ministries, as well as the gifts that you have given through your time and talents throughout the community. Our offertory prayer. Let us pray. God of abundance, you caused streams to break forth in the desert and manna to rain from the heavens. Accept the gifts you have first given us. Unite them with the offering of our lives to nourish the world you love so dearly. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. May children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Holy One, you have raised up faithful leaders throughout history. Empower those discerning a call to ministry and all seminarians that they continue to be formed for the sake of the gospel. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You have established a diverse and beautiful creation. Revive declining species and preserve endangered lands. Cultivate in us a sense of wonder for the world you created. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You desire for us not to be alone and to live in community with one another. Strengthen relationships between nations and peoples, that we celebrate and support one human family. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You share in our experiences and struggles. Bless all who live with any mental or physical disability. Inspire creative communities, spaces, and environments that are accessible and hospitable. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You have established and nurtured relationships that extend beyond those gathered here today. Bless members who can no longer travel to worship with us, especially Leda Mae, Martha, Raymond, Billy, Bee, Marion, Iris, Darlene, Jane, Maydell, and Wanda, and remind us of their continued role in this community of faith. Be with those who have requested our prayers, Debbie, Rodney, Ed, Kim, Gerald, Orville, Pat, Nikki, Dewey, Marilyn, Matt, Lisa, Willie, Lillian, Linda, Ted, Leah, Roger, Ivy, and Donna. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
The congregation may offer prayers aloud or silently at this time. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You promise eternal life to all your children. Thank you for the people of faith who have gone before us. Strengthen our trust we have in you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
At this time, I invite you to have in your hands your communion. I invite you to hold that as an extension of this table. So while I say the blessing here, I'm also saying it over the gifts that you hold. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love, you sent to us Jesus, your son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out your Holy Spirit, that by this holy communion we may know the unity we share with all your people in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
All who hunger and thirst, come. The table is ready. I invite you now to partake in the meal. The body of Christ given for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you.
In the gift of your body and blood, you turn the crumbs of our faith into a feast of salvation. Send us forth into the world with shouts of joy, bearing witness to the abundance of your love in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Receive the benediction. People of God, you are Christ's body, bringing new life to a suffering world. The Holy Trinity, one God, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Go in peace. The living word dwells in you.
Thanks be to God.